This is my confidence, you never fail me yet. I know the night won't last, your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again.
Sing it again.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence.
Yeah.
to foe, still your love far from me.
Thank you, Jesus.
You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. So, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I don't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. No shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Sing it again.
I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. That was good, that was good. At this time, we're going to go ahead and take communion, which is going to be over to the right. And this is something you guys are very familiar with, I'm sure. But the reality is, it's a time for believers to remember the foundation of the Christian faith. The reality that we're not good enough to accomplish good works on our own. That we can't save ourselves, and that we're in desperate need of a Savior. But the good news is that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, came and lived the life that we could not live, and died the death that we deserve. And when we take communion, we take the cup, which represents the blood of Jesus poured out for our sin. And we take the bread, which represents his body that was broken for us. And that should change our response. So I just want you guys, as you take the communion, to be praying through that. Over there, there's also offering in this time of worship. You guys have heard me talk about offering and just kind of what I believe the Bible talks about with giving. And the reality is that God is infinitely wealthy and has absolutely no need of our money. God is the creator of you. He's the creator of me. He's the creator of the tree or the cloth or whatever money's printed on. He has no need of it. But what he wants is your heart. And the reality is, in this world, we have so many things that we hold on to, whether it's our time, our titles, our television shows, our money, or whatever it is. And I just want to encourage you to pray through how God wants to speak to you today and how God wants to move your heart and to reach you for him. So in this time of worship, would you just continue that? All right, we're going to continue in our time of worship to the Lord. And we actually, so in this last week when we were kind of preparing what we were going to sing, what we were going to talk about, and really just kind of the mission of the church and really what God's been putting on our heart, the mission statement that we came up with was that we exist to worship God the Father in spirit and in truth, through gospel-centered, spirit-led community with one another. And that comes from John 4:23. So I just decided to do a quick search for a song, Spirit and Truth, because I was like, that would be cool if there was a song. And there was a song called Spirit and Truth from Bethel Church by Sean Foyt. And I fell in love with the words. And it's just such a powerful song. So it's a new song that we're going to teach you guys today. And I'm just going to run through the words real quick. It says, all we want is to see you. All we long is to know you. Our hearts undone. Renew our hunger again. You're reaching past our agendas. You're piercing through the familiar. You bring us back into wonder again. In spirit and truth, we're running back to you. Oh, my soul will worship you. With our arms held high, this love of ours will rise. Oh, my soul will worship you. You're drawing us closer than we've ever been and taking us deeper than we've ever known. We're seeing you clearer than we've ever seen. We're giving you all we are, our everything. In spirit and truth, we're running back to you. Take me back to my first love. So I really thought it was such a fitting song for just the context of who we want to be as a church, and that God desires people to worship him in spirit and in truth, for God is spirit. Up there it says, but the hour is coming and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And what I love about that is you basically have a Trinitarian statement right here. So the Bible doesn't use the word Trinity, but when you think about God as the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, this is such a beautiful illustration of that, because you worship God the Father in spirit and in truth. And who's the way, the truth, and the life? Jesus. So you really have all three members of the Trinity represented there. So I think it's awesome. If you guys would just join. It's a pretty simple song to pick up, and if you don't know it and you just want to listen for now, that's okay. But just try and pick up where you can.
We're giving you all we are, our everything, our everything.
esteem. We're giving you all we are, our everything, our everything.
In spirit and truth, we're running back to you. Oh, my soul will worship you.
With our arms held high, this love of ours will rise. Oh, my soul will worship you.
Take me back to my first love. 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 To my first love, take me back to my first love.
Take me back to my first love, take me back to my first love, take me back to my first love.
In spirit and truth, we're running back to you. On an unrelated note, the position of piano player and worship leader has opened up. So if that is your giftedness and your calling and your skill set, we would love for you to get plugged in here and be able to help lead us in worship to the Lord. Yeah, you guys can go ahead and grab a seat, as many of you have.
There's some chairs over here.
This is love.
You guys want me to talk with or without the mic? What's better?
With the microphone. Right, I'm going to turn it down a little bit. Because I do have the tendency to get loud, as many of you guys know very well. So I'm going to go ahead and open us up in a word of prayer. And I think prayer has just become kind of a checkbox thing for us in a lot of circles. And one of the things that God had really put on my heart for this community, this church, is that we want prayer to be an act of worship. We want prayer to be a discipline. We want prayer to be something that we see value in, something that we do together as a body. So before we begin the sermon, would you go ahead and join me one more time in prayer? God, I pray that you would move in this place as you already have. Just as you've been doing all week and just preparing this place, preparing our hearts for what you have for us today. Lord, as I stand here, I am so grateful that it is not about me, it is not about us, it is about you and what you want to do, Lord. That when we go in our weakness and in our fear and we go disabled, Lord, you are strong and you are capable and you show that it is not about us. Lord, I pray that in this time today, Lord, that you would just allow the work of the Holy Spirit to illuminate your word and allow us to understand it in new ways that we've never seen before, Lord. I pray that you would stir our affections for Jesus and that you would allow the work of regeneration to begin in our hearts, Lord, that we would be convicted and changed by the word of God, that we would not just be going through life continuing to do what we always do and justifying our actions, Lord, but instead that we would have a real conviction to live in submission to what you have called us to, Lord. We love you and thank you in your name.
Amen.
Amen. So, yes, amen, amen. So I am so excited to share just what God has been putting on my heart in these past few weeks and really what led to this moment here today. There's been a lot going on behind the scenes. There's been a lot that I have learned about myself. I learned that I'm very impatient, that I talk way too fast, and I have a loving fiance to point that out many, many times. And I know that I have a lot to tell you guys, and I want to share it because I'm so excited about it. But I know that I should kind of divide it out a little bit. So I'm going to do my best to speak clearly, to speak slowly, and to kind of preach what God has called me to preach. So I basically wrote a sermon and then split it up into 5 sermons because I realized, Daniel, there's no way you can talk about that in 30 or 40 minutes. So yeah, if I get too fast, Just go ahead and break. Actually, no, don't do that. I'm just going to speak fast. It'll be great. The other thing that, as I was kind of thinking about the name, the Image Church, and there's just been so many times that God just kind of put something on my heart, or just a thought had crossed my mind that was really powerful. And one of the first ones that happened was that, like I mentioned before, this church is a work in progress. And I kind of thought to myself, like, yeah, we are a work in progress. Like, that's okay. We can lean into that. That's good. And then I realized the reality is that if you read scripture, okay, so this is never going to happen again. You guys understand this. So this was a demonstration that I scheduled to make sure you guys turn off your phones during church. It is not about me. It is about God. Amen. Yeah, so the thought that we are a work in progress, and the reality is that as individuals, we're going to be an unfinished work until glory, that we're called to be made more and more like Christ daily. And as a church, we're an unfinished work, that we're never going to arrive at this point where we get to stop trying. But the reality is that we're always going to be a work in progress, asking where God wants to change and use us in our specific context. And the illustration that I kind of came to mind was, I have a 4-year-old niece. I was hoping she was going to be here today. I think she's watching on Facebook Live right now. But I remember when she was first learning to walk, it was a really exciting time because all of us wanted her to walk so badly, and we were so excited when she started taking those first steps. And I remember sitting in the living room and kind of watching her do her little toddler like stumble thing. And we were so excited. And she fell, and we picked her back up, and she kept going. And I can tell you, not for 1 second did it cross my mind, how dare you fall? Come back when you can run. Not at all. The reality is that we are a baby church, that I am a baby preacher, and I'm gonna ask you guys to have grace with me and grace with one another, because we're gonna have some missteps, we're gonna have some stumbles and some falls, but the reality is that God wants to make us better through that, and that he's gonna teach us to walk, he's gonna teach us to run for his kingdom, amen? Amen. So that kind of takes a burden off my shoulders, so let's get preaching, here we go. So this moment has been in the work for a long time, and I had no idea that this is what it was going to look like. Last month, I could not have told you anything about this room right here or what God was going to do. But I've known since I was 5 that I wanted to be a preacher. And my mom can tell you, my kindergarten yearbook picture, I decided I wanted to wear a suit. And everyone was a little confused and said, why are you wearing a suit? Well, because I'm going to be a preacher, and preachers wear suits. It's just what you do. And at the time, I'm pretty sure that's the only thing I thought preachers did. They talk on stage and wear a suit. And I was all about that life. But the reality is that that is something that God put in my heart at an early age. And he has been close to me ever since. In every step of the journey, he has just continued to shape and mold what that calling looks like. And taught me so much more about what it means to shepherd and care for and love other people. So I just want to share a little bit of my testimony. A lot of you guys might know this, and this may be a review for you. But so when I was 5, I wanted to be a preacher. And I went to Hillcrest Christian School. It was a private Christian school, and we had Bible classes. It turned into Heritage Christian School, and we have 2 teachers from Heritage over there. Woo-hoo! From my alma mater that kind of doesn't exist anymore. So I grew up, and we took Bible classes. They were really, really easy. For a while, you just basically had to memorize scripture, and you can get 100%, and it wasn't really formative. It wasn't too much growth, but I mean, I guess you were in the Word of God. And then I got to middle school. And I met a professor by the name of David Williamson. And I'm going to be honest, I went through a little bit of shell shock when I saw his syllabus. Miles Penn can attest, he was in that class as well. This guy must have been passionate about teaching young men about learning the Word of God and studying the Word of God, because he had this like 80-page doctrinal booklet that we had to go through. We had to like write out the book of 2 Timothy like scribes with like a pencil and like a quill and feather, something crazy. And we had to like memorize the entire book of 2 Timothy. And all of this was so daunting. And I was like, man, this like what happened to the easy Bible classes that I can get 100% and do some pinwheel art projects on? But the reality is that I'm so glad that God put him in my life, because that was such a formative time. Because all of us, especially when you grow up in the church like I did, you kind of tag on to your parents' faith or your pastor's faith. And the reality is that at some point you have to understand and know that you have to have a relationship with God. See, God doesn't want to have a relationship with you through someone else. He wants to have a relationship with you directly. And you can't tag on to your parents' faith. You can't tag on to this or that. So this was a time where I really was able to read the Word of God and understand and say, man, okay, what do I believe? Man, maybe there's some doubts that are sitting there. How do I wrestle with these? Let's kind of walk on this journey. And that was such an amazing time. Because I think being in the church, it's very easy to think, well, as long as I'm in church, I'm a Christian. But that's like saying, as long as you're in a garage, you're a car. It just doesn't make sense. It doesn't work. It's not a good illustration. But that was really kind of where it started my journey. And throughout high school, obviously there's always ups and downs throughout life. That's what it means to be a believer, that we're going to struggle. But it was just an incredible time. And there have been so many moments in friendships and relationships that God put in my life and mentors that God put over me just to continue to push me towards him. And that led me to Biola University. Biola University is the best university, way better than Azusa Pacific. Way, way better than Azusa Pacific. Oh, sorry. Kate went to Azusa. But we pray for her, and it's all good now. We've cleared it up. No, it's a great school. But I went to Biola, and it was the only school I wanted to apply to. Like I said, I've known since I was 5 that I wanted to be a preacher, and that school just kind of stood out to me as one that I wanted to learn to think biblically about everything, which is kind of their mission statement, and learn what it means to study the Bible. And it was kind of crazy. Every year, God almost had a different theme for me. And what was even crazier about that time is that I didn't have a normal class schedule. I did a double major in biblical studies and in music. You wouldn't be able to tell from this, but I did take music classes, I promise. They just didn't teach me how to play the piano. So I took like a weird class schedule because I basically was taking third year classes as a first year, and it was all these kind of weird intermingling. And somehow every day, all of my professors were talking about the exact same thing in different themes that God had me throughout the year. And that was kind of when I realized, man, maybe there is something to this whole Holy Spirit living in believers and kind of guiding things and teaching us and using different people to teach us what God has for us. And it was just an incredible time. Coming to the end of that schooling, I was kind of looking to get plugged into a church. I was eager. I wanted to start preaching or go somewhere and do something, and I didn't really know what that looked like. I was trying to apply to a couple internships at different churches around the area, and really just didn't get any traction on that. And then I got a call from Kayla Francis, and they were looking for someone to come help on the Westside campus when we moved from the VA over here. And at that time, it was a crossroads. It was a time that I didn't really know. This didn't really seem like it fit what God had ultimately called me to do, but maybe he was calling me into a season of training. I didn't know. And the reality is I didn't have a specific heart for West Los Angeles. I didn't know any of you guys here today, but I kind of stepped out in faith because it seemed that this is where God was leading me. And I can tell you guys, I am so glad that he did. I cannot imagine if I had rebelled what I was going to do. It's kind of frustrating because the last 3 years, I've learned more than I did in my entire time in Bible college. And the frustrating part is I'm carrying debts for Bible college, and I'm not carrying debts for the last 3 years being able to work on the Westside campus. But God has just been teaching me so much. Just being able to do ministry, being able to hear you guys' stories, being able to connect with people, and being able to have people who want to support this church out here and want to be the church in West Los Angeles. I'm just so grateful and so humbled that God guided me to the Westside campus. And then it came to the last month. Obviously, we kind of knew some things were going on. We were trying to figure out a couple different routes and options. We didn't really know what that looked like. On January 15th, I proposed to my then girlfriend, Kate Somoza, who is now my fiance. Yes. And then I get an email that the Westside campus is closing down. And my initial response was, God, this isn't good timing. You told me to do this. You told me to propose. And then, like, what's going on here? Can you help me make sense of this? But I can tell you that God knows way better than I do. Because the reality is that without her, none of this would have happened. Without her pointing me back to Christ every step of the way, telling me, Daniel, you like to talk and run and do. Just shut up and listen for a second. Just be still and know that he is God. Just go to the Lord in prayer. I need that in my life. And this would have been a very different picture. This would have been me trying to force it and muscle my way in and not going with God's blessing. So I am so grateful that I listened to his timing and not my timing. And in this time, so basically after I kind of got that email, I didn't feel peace that God was calling me away from the West Side. He's given me a heart and a passion for the people here in this room, for the people in this city that need to hear about Jesus. The reality is that God can start a revival in this city that can go out from the most unlikely of places, because that's what God does throughout the Bible. God chooses the most unlikely heroes to accomplish the most amazing work so that there is no doubt in our minds that it is God moving and not us. So I really wanted to say, God, this doesn't make sense. This is not stable. I'm trying to look at starting a family. Can you just make it clear for me if this is the route that I'm supposed to go? And what he did, he showed up in a really, really cool way. So like I said, there was kind of these moments throughout that I had these epiphanies, revelations, but the cool thing is that all of them were tied to a specific passage of scripture. So what I ended up with is 5 sermons about how God called us to this place. So that's a little bit of my testimony that led me here, and you're going to get a little bit more of that as we go through. So I want to outline the next few months of what we're going to be talking about. So the first sermon series that I want to launch into is called Recalculating Route. There we go. Oh, back. There we go. Boom. Back. There we go. So how many of you guys use the GPS on your phone? Wow, you guys need to use the GPS more. It's an amazing tool. It's awesome. I use the GPS way too much. Arguably to a fault. As soon as I discovered that you can look and see traffic in real time and bypass that traffic in LA, I honestly do not go anywhere without my GPS. I put it in to go, I think I put it in this morning to get here. It's crazy. But the most reassuring thing for me is when I make a wrong turn, which Kate can attest I do often because I'm distracted or something. When I make a wrong turn, it doesn't say, you screwed up, you might as well go back home and give up. All it says is recalculating route. And that's the most reassuring thing in the world because I know I can keep making wrong turns and keep trying to do it my own way and say, I think I might know better than you. I'm going to take this street instead. And it's just going to keep saying recalculating route, recalculating route, recalculating route. And I might end up taking a lot longer to get to the destination, but it's going to keep moving me towards that. Because you see, this app, or the brains behind Google, I don't know how the mystic stuff works, but they have more information than I do. They have a bigger picture. They can look and see real-time traffic. They can see all the streets. They can see blocks ahead and road closures and figure out the best way to get us where we're going. And the reality is that that's exactly what God does with us. That in our free will, he allows us to make choices, and he allows us to ignore his voice. And all that's in that for us is a longer time and more pain. And the reality is if we would just tune in to listen to his voice and trust that he has a bigger picture of where we're going, then we'll get to our destination. Where he wants to take us is way better than we can get on our own. So that's the sermon series, and it's going to be 5 parts. Today we're going to be talking about Gideon from Judges chapter 6, and the sermon title is called Equipping the Called. You can go to the next slide. Thank you so much. By the way, last night I asked her to do slides, and she's doing it today with no training. So let's give it up for her. That's awesome, Sierra. That is so great. So the first sermon is going to be called Equipping the Called, and that's what we're going to be talking about today in Gideon chapter 6. Sermon number 2 next week, make sure you guys come in, is going to be called You're Not the Point, and that's going to be Judges 7. We're going to look at Joshua in the Battle of Jericho with Chain of Command, and then we're going to look at What's in a Name. And what we're going to talk about there is kind of Genesis 1, the name, the image, church. And what that means, that inherently we are all human beings made in the image of God, no matter what you struggle with, no matter male, female, no matter who you are, your economic status, anything you can think of, you are a human being made in the image of God. And with that comes certain responsibilities, if you can just see with the eyes that the Father has for his children who are hurting and desperately need a Savior, then it's just going to change a lot of things. And then we're going to talk about John 4:23, which we read in the song earlier, which is that the Father desires people to worship him in spirit and in truth. And then the last week is going to kind of be a setup for our next series. It's going to be called We Are the Church. We're going to be looking at the Great Commission and kind of looking at the position that we're at. So what I think is unique about this is church has become so much about things that they do just because they do it. And the reality is that we want to get back to the basics of who has God called the church to be. And what is the foundation of these are the things that we want to be, no matter if we're in a pizzeria, in a parking lot, in a park, in a building or a restaurant, wherever we are, we want to be the church that God has called us to be. And then we want to look and say, man, I think God's called us in our specific context to reach people in a unique way. And that's where we're going to get into things like children's ministry and all the different things. So we have kids today. I love that you're here, man. This is awesome. If you get bored, I'm sorry. But the reality is that it gives us a chance to look at different things. Children's ministry is an amazing thing. And I have no problem if God calls us to bring up a children's ministry, but it's not a requirement of a church. See, there's also value in having the church, all generations, having the kids and the adults of all ages worshiping the Father in spirit and truth together. And the reality is there are going to be some things that go over your head, bud, and that's okay. If you don't understand something, your mom will gladly help you understand it. So we want to partner with. Feel free to ask questions afterwards. And we're excited to have them in here. So all that to say, we just want to kind of start from scratch and look and say, all right, Christ came and lived the life that you couldn't live and died the death you deserve. He was buried in 3 days. He rose from the dead and said, be my church. Go make disciples of all nations. Now what? And that's really the position that we're in, is we're trying to figure out. We don't want to just do things because they've always been done. We don't want to do things because other churches do that, because that might be their calling. But we want to ask God, what are you calling us to? And the other thing with that is that I'm hoping that in this season, there's a little bit of a transition from a come and see mentality to a go and tell mentality. And to kind of shift away from kind of consumeristic church, where it's like, okay, how does the church meet my needs? All right, is the worship what I like? Is the preaching what I like? Instead, I want to say, man, we want to be a part of this, and we want to go and tell people about it. And we want to be the church in here, and we want to help make it better. Instead of just cutting and running when there's something we don't like, let's try and be part of that community and solution, have grace with one another. And the second thing is, it's really easy, man. I felt this so much in this process. Because there's so many needs that you feel like you need to have. And the temptation is to call people up and say, hey man, these are all of our needs in the church. Can you come and serve in one of these? But the reality is that I don't think that's what the church is called to be. I think more so, we need to ask, how has God gifted you? How has he called you? And what are you passionate about? And then find a way to use your giftedness for this church. Because I think instead of trying to create ministries and then staff them on our own, I think we can trust that who God has in this church, in this room, is very intentional. And the giftedness that he has for this place is going to be enough and sufficient for our context. Amen. So I want to encourage you guys to be praying through that. Let me know if you know something, if you say, man, I'm really gifted in teaching. I'm really gifted in playing the piano. I'm really gifted in this area. Man, I just love to work. I don't mind moving boxes. And I just love, is there a place I can serve like that? If there's not, we want to create it. Because we want you to use how God has designed you in this place. So that brings us to our next series. We're going to be studying through the book of Acts. And I'm not sure exactly how long it's going to take yet. Still getting there. Like I said, work in progress. Drink water. And for my next trick. But yeah, we're going to be studying through the book of Acts. Because I can think of no better way to start a church than to looking at the start of the church. And just reading that together and just understanding what God has called us to be. So make sure you guys are here over the next few weeks, because it is going to be good, I hope. No, well, God is good. God is good. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them up to Judges chapter 6. That's where we're going to be spending our time today. We're going to be looking at the life of Gideon. If you don't have one, there's a couple, I believe, outside or over here now. There's a couple Bibles over here. Or you guys, I know we don't have sermon notes, so you guys are more than welcome to take out your phones, and you guys can take notes on there, and you guys can use the Bible app on there if you would like. And I think we're also going to have the scripture on the screen when we go up. But we're going to look at the life of Gideon and see how it can teach us to overcome our fears by showing us someone who is not brave. And this is actually a unique kind of take to it. I heard Pastor J.D. Greer preach a sermon on Judges, and it was the first time I kind of saw what he was talking about. I always thought of Gideon as this mighty man of valor, but when you start understanding the story, there's a little bit more nuance to it. So just a little context before we start reading. In the beginning of chapter 6, right at the bat, we see a very similar sight throughout the Old Testament. The people of Israel have once again wandered from God and are now being afflicted by the Midianites. They're basically tearing through the crops. So the Israelites are trying to grow these crops, and the Midianites are coming through and just destroying them right away, taking them like middle schoolers at a brunch buffet. They're just, it's gone before it can even get up there. And the Israelites are crying out to God, because they're in caves. They're trying to grow crops in caves. They're trying to do everything in secret so that they don't know what's being grown, so they can't take it. And they cry out to God, and God sends Gideon as a judge. So we're going to read Judges 6, 11 through 27, if you could follow along. And this is a long passage, and there's a reason that I want to read it all, because I believe that the word of God is enough to speak for itself, and I don't want to continue to stop and interrupt the whole time, so I just want to read it through and then break it down after. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abizurite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said, "The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor." And Gideon said to him, "Please, my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? And where are all his wonderful deeds that our fathers recounted to us, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us out from Egypt?' But now the Lord has forsaken us and given us into the hand of Midian." And the Lord turned to him and said, go in this might of yours and save Israel from the hand of Midian. Do I not send you? And he said to him, please, Lord, how can I save Israel? Behold, my clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am least in my father's house. And the Lord said to him, but I will be with you, and you shall strike the Midianites as one man. And he said to him, if now I have found favor in your eyes, then show me a sign that it is you who speaks with me. Please do not depart from here until I come to you and bring out my present and set it before you. And he said, I will stay till you return. So Gideon went into his house and prepared a young goat and unleavened cakes from an ephah of flour. And he put meat in a basket and broth in a pot. And he brought them under the terebinth and presented them. That sounds yummy. And the angel of God said to him, take the meat and unleavened cakes and put them on this rock and pour the broth over them. And he did so. Then the angel of the Lord reached out the tip of the staff that was in his hand and touched the meat and the unleavened cakes. And fire sprang up from the rock and consumed the meat and unleavened cakes. And the angel of the Lord vanished from his sight. Then Gideon perceived that he was an angel of the Lord. And Gideon said, alas, O Lord God, for now I have seen an angel of the Lord face to face. But the Lord said to him, peace be with you. Do not fear. You shall not die. Then Gideon built an altar there to the Lord and called it the Lord is peace. To this day, it still stands at Ophrah, which belongs to the Abizarites. That night, the Lord said to him, take your father's bull and the second bull, 7 years old, and pull down the altar of Baal that your father has, and cut down the Asherah that is beside it, and build on it an altar to the Lord your God on the top of the stronghold here, with stones laid in due order. Then take the second bull and offer it as a burnt offering with the wood of the Asherah that you cut down. So Gideon took 10 of his servants and did as the Lord said. But because he was too afraid of his family and the men of the town to do it by day, he did it by night. So that's a long passage. Thank you, guys. But let's stop there because I think there's a few things that we can pull from this passage and some stuff that I want to point out. So the first thing is something that I didn't really notice. You see, this passage was kind of step one on my journey of how God led me to this place of starting the church. Because I remember Gideon as laying out the fleece and God doing some spectacular sign to give him supernatural clarity and moving forward. And that's what I wanted before I could start a church out here. But the reality is what God showed me was so much better than what I thought I wanted. So in 6:11, you can see that Gideon is not a courageous superhero. You see, he's under oppression by the Midianites. He's actually in a wine press, basically hiding in a hole. Last week, you guys heard Dudley's sermon about kind of throwing up the chaff and letting the wind blow it. That's what he was doing, but he was doing it in a cave. Now, I don't know about you, but there's not usually a lot of wind in caves, so that must have been a very difficult task, but that's where he was hiding. You see, the calling isn't who you are. It's who God is making you into, because when I think of a man of valor, I don't think of a man hiding in a cave. But God sees us when we're a mess and declares us pure, righteous, holy, and blameless overcomers. Not only that, we see Gideon afterwards, he goes to pull down the altar to Baal in the city square. But he doesn't want to do it by day because he's afraid of his family. He's afraid of the people in the village. So he decides to do it by night. So we don't see this kind of superhero that we think of Gideon, man of valor. But that's the title that the angel of the Lord gives to him. See, it's not the title of who he is right now. It's who God is calling him to be. If he'll just step out in faith, in obedience. And sometimes it's trembling obedience. Sometimes it's scary. See, God is far less concerned with how great you are and more concerned that we know how great he is. Pastor J.D. Greer puts it this way, that God doesn't call the brave. He makes brave the called. And that's the first point if you guys are taking notes on the screen. And then it moves on to the second part. Gideon says to God, God, who am I? I'm insignificant. And his response is, but I'm going to be with you. It's not about you. Yes, you are. That's the point. It's not about you. You see, Gideon continued to be scared even in the midst of his obedience. I'd call it a trembling obedience. See, courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is continuing to trust and follow God in the midst of the fear. The response that God gives to Gideon in this season is the same one that he gives to us. That I'm going to be with you. That you're not going alone. That you have a cloud of witnesses. That I've got your back. It's not you going alone. So this scene between Gideon and God, we see that the cure for fear is trust, not courage. The more fully and completely you surrender and trust God, the more fear subsides. Even if it's not perfect at first, the more you continue to walk in this discipline, the better it gets. And the reality is that this formula works no matter where you want to apply it. It works to all sorts of areas of life. A couple examples that come to mind. How many of you guys know about the Sky Slide in LA? You guys know about that? One, two, okay. So there is this slide up on like the 34th story or some crazy high building, and it's a glass slide. And it basically goes out away from the building and then comes back in. You're like over nothing, okay? So here's the deal. If I'm gonna get on that slide, I wanna know that it was built by professionals. I don't want Bubba in his backyard saying, I got some glass, I'm gonna build a slide up. No, I wanna know that there was permitting. I wanna know that it's a trustworthy slide. Otherwise, I'm gonna be terrified the entire time down. You see, the more trust I have in the builder, the less fear I'm gonna have going down. Or another one, this one astonishes me, shooting an apple off of someone's head. I think they pretty much outlawed it today, but whenever you see those videos, I'm terrified the entire time. I'm like, I'm glad that worked out, but I don't wanna see someone die today. I'm not about that life. But if you're gonna sit there and put an apple on your head and let someone shoot at it, you've gotta trust the person shooting that, you've gotta trust the equipment, you've gotta have a lot of trust if you're not gonna have fear. Another one is throwing knives at the spinning board of the magicians that go through. I'm sure there was a trick to that one, but it came to mind, so I thought I'd share it with you. But there's one major difference about putting your trust in things, putting your trust in man, and then putting your trust in God. Because he's the only being, only thing in the universe that's actually worthy of our trust. Because he's the only one who is capable of never letting you down. The reality is he is all powerful, he is infinite, he is eternal. At some point, anything else you put your faith, hope, and trust in will let you down. Whether it rots and rusts and destroys, or whether humans just kind of do their human thing and they let you down. So things will most certainly let you down as the newness wears off, but God will never fail. He is faithful until the end. Amen. Amen. Romans 4:17 says, faith is believing what God says is going to be true, even when it doesn't look like it's going to be true. And it tells the story of Abraham, because throughout the Bible, we see this concept of God choosing the weak and insignificant to shame the strong, to show that it is not about us and our power. And that's what the story of Gideon is about, and we're going to see that in chapter 7 next week. But in Abraham, we see a childless old man with a barren wife that God calls to be the father of many nations. In Moses, we see an outcast with a speech impediment that God says, you're going to lead people. You're going to lead them out of Egypt, and you are going to be the voice of God. Your words are going to move nations. In David, we see a young shepherd who God calls to take down Goliath and to be the king of Israel. And in Gideon, we see a scared man hiding in a winepress who God calls to be a mighty man of valor to save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. The good news for you and me is that he still does that with us today. While we're still messed up in our problems and struggles and imperfections, he says that he's going to make us into saints and overcomers if we're just trust him and step out in obedience and allow him to do what he does best. And sometimes that means trembling obedience. I'm human. I know that even in this process, there have been times of kind of taking that trembling, shaky step and just going out. But the second you do, God shows up. So there's a question that I'm sure you're all asking. Okay, but how do we know God is with us? How do we know it's not just our own mind talking? And I love that you guys are right there with me in my notes, because that's exactly what I'm about to talk about. This is the same question that Gideon had throughout the whole process of his calling. After tearing down the altar to Baal and essentially starting a war, the Midianites were furious and wanted to kill Gideon. And they basically were, where is he? We're going to kill him. We're going to kill him. And they went to Joash, his dad. And they said, where's Gideon? Bring him out so we can kill him. And his dad goes to bat for him in an awesome way. He says, if your God's so powerful, then why hasn't he killed him yet? Can your God not fend for himself? You would think if someone desecrated his altar that much, then he would be able to rebel. Does he need you to save him and fight for him? And basically, Gideon kind of got the title of God Slayer. And then after this, instead of going to kill Gideon, they decide they're just going to kind of get their army together. And the Midianites get about 100,000 troops together. And then God uses Gideon to call his troops together. And I'm going to give you a little bit of a preview, but basically God's math is God takes 100,000 versus 33,000 and says the 33,000 Israelites are too many. Let's cut them down. Gets down to 10,000. All right, those are 10 to 1 odds. All right, God, I think you can do that. Maybe 10,000 brave soldiers are better than 32,000 just fearful soldiers. Okay. And God says, no, you're still going to think it's about you if you beat them with 10,000. Let's just do a random test. Let's go down to the water, drink up some liquid, and if they basically lap it up like a dog, then we'll keep them. And God cuts the army down from 32,000 to 300. And with the 300 men, he defeats 100,000 Midianite soldiers without losing a single life, because it is not about them. It is about God. So, it's a little bit of a preview for next week. But that brings us to verse 36. So Gideon is now on the eve of battle. So he's taken steps of obedience, and he's walking step by step, but he's still scared. And he's still asking God, God, can you show me that you're here? And to me, this is one of the most reassuring things ever, because God is very patient with Gideon. If someone was this like indecisive and said, Daniel, can I go? Are you sure? You sure you want me to go? Okay, yeah, I know you said you wanted me to go, but you sure you want me to go? Yeah, no, I know you said that, but now do you want me to go? I would be exhausted, and I would say, no, just don't go anymore. I'm going to choose someone else. But God is patient, and God is good. So we're going to pick it back up in verse 36. Then Gideon said to God, if you will save Israel by my hand, as you have said, behold, I am laying a fleece of wool on the threshing floor. If there is dew on the fleece alone, and it is dry on all the ground, then I shall know that you will save Israel by my hand, as you have said. And it was so, when he rose early the next morning and squeezed the fleece, he wrung out enough dew from the fleece to fill a bowl with water. Then Gideon said to God, let not your anger burn against me. Let me speak just once more. Please let me test just once more with the fleece. But this time, I want it to be dry on the fleece only, and all around let the ground, let there be dew. And God, being patient as he is, did so that night. And it was dry on the fleece only, and all around there was dew. Man, that is encouraging for us today. Like I told you before, this is what I wanted from God. I took a day of solitude, and I went over to the Getty Villa, which is an awesome place, by the way, if you guys haven't been over there. And really just tried to have some time to be quiet with God. And I was sitting there staring at this palm tree, and I'm like, God, can you just give me this clear sign so you can just send me forward. Just send a giant gust to blow through that palm tree so I know you're here and I know you're sending me forward. And then that's it. That's all we have to do. We know we're good. It's all taken care of. And then I read the story and realized that's not what happened. And then I also kind of got a very clear confirmation from God saying, that's not what you need. It's in my power. You know that I control all things. You know that I can send a breeze and blow it through the trees. But the reality is that if I do that for you, you're going to see this calling and this ministry as a catapult. And that's not what it is. You see, this isn't a point and shoot thing. God doesn't want to just send us in one direction with our own power and will running forward. He wants to be the wind in our sails. He wants to be the captain of the ship. And he wants to be the rudder and continue to guide us every step of the way. And for me in this process, prayer is a hard discipline for me. I mean, I end up getting to this point where I'm like, man, God, if I really just want your way that's better than my way, then why do I even ask you to change my situation? And then I realize how stupid that is and unbiblical and all that stuff. And I get back on my knees and say, okay, I get it, God, I'll pray to you. But the reality is that in this process, as I'm looking at becoming the pastor of a church, which is insane, as I'm looking at becoming part of a body of believers that's brand new and baby Christian or baby church and all this stuff, it can't be in my own power because I'm not good enough to do it. You see, if anything good happens here, it is not of me. God chose me, the weakest of all, to shame the strong, because it's about him. Amen. So I want to encourage you in that. And the last point from this is that Gideon asks God for a fleece. And a lot of times we want to use this passage to say, okay, well, this means that we can just do litmus tests for God. We can just put him to the test whenever we want him to do something. And I'm not saying that there's a bad thing in asking for confirmation from God in certain seasons. But that's not the point of this passage. The main point is Gideon asking that question, how do I know that you are with me? And the answer for us today who have put our hope in Jesus is way better than a wet or dry fleece. It's point number three, the cross is our wet fleece. You see, we have the cross of Jesus. The cross shows us that God is for us and proves to us that he will never leave us. That's what gives us courage to move forward. Throughout Scripture, we have countless assurances of God's promises that are fulfilled in the person and work of Jesus Christ. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare to even die. But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God didn't wait for you to be powerful or strong on your own accord. While you were in the worst of your despairs, Christ died for you and called you out. And he didn't die for a perfect version of you that says, well, as long as you don't sin from this point forward, then we're good. If you do, we're deals off. No, 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 no. He sees his child, past, present, and future, struggles and stumbles and trips and falls and all, and says, that's who I want for my kingdom. That's who I'm dying for. That's what the blood of this cross is going to cover. That's from Romans 5, 7, 8. In 1 John 4:18, it tells us that perfect love casts out fear. In Numbers 23, 21 through 23, it says that if God is with us, then no sorcery can stand against us. In Psalm 56, 11, it says, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid, for what can man do to me? In Romans 8, 31, it says, if God is for us, then who can be against us? Man, if you realize the person who is behind us, you realize the person who is calling the shots, who is driving the ship, if you allow that to be God, then you don't have to fear man. You see, if you have a right understanding of who God is, the only rational fear in the world is God. One of the best illustrations of this is Paul, who says, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. I think a lot of people are basically afraid of death. People are afraid of snakes. It kind of leads to, I don't want to die by a snake. People are afraid of planes. Well, I don't want to die by a plane. Whatever it is, that's kind of suffering or pain or whatever. But Paul says, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Those are the only two options. This is a guy who understood that God was the center of his life, that this time that we have on earth is so small compared to eternity, and that we want to live lives that are impacting the kingdom. And we want to enjoy the earth that God has given us with one another, in community with one another, because that's how God has designed us. God's not putting out the rules just to be the strict disciplinarian. He's putting them there for our good and for his glory. So I want to encourage you guys today to ask how God wants to move your life. And as we look back on the story of Gideon, I want to remember the three things. One, God makes brave the call. He doesn't call the brave. Two, courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is a following God in the midst of the fear. And three, the cross is our wet fleece. If you're waiting on God to give you all you need before you obey, then you're never going to start. If you take that first step of obedience, I just want to let you know that God will equip you. He's going to equip you with obedience. That's the reward. I want to challenge you to look at what God's calling you to do in this season and take that first step of obedience instead of waiting around. And I don't know what that is. Only you're going to know that. But I know that this church is going to have a lot of needs. Seeing the people who have come around me this morning, and there's no way I could have done all this by myself. My mom is incredible. My fiance is incredible. Her dad is incredible. Patrick is incredible. All the people who are in here are incredible. So I just want you to consider, God, what are you calling me to do? Where are you calling me to go? Because at the fundamental foundation of the church, we're not called just to be hearers of the word, we're called to be doers of the word. So here my heart and my hope is that as we read what the word says and try to practice what it teaches, we would then go out and share what it promises, which is the hope of salvation through Jesus Christ. Would you join me in prayer as we close? God, we thank you for what you've done in this place, and we thank you for just moving here today, Lord God. I pray that you take the messed up jumble of words that have come out of my mouth for your glory, Lord, and that you use this as a sweet offering and you use this to impact the kingdom, Lord God. Lord, I pray that you would keep us humble every step of the way. That this would be a group of people that just fall humbly before the cross, not seeking to make great our own name, but seeking to make great the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Lord, I pray that, as you know my own sinful desires, that I want to be known, Lord, but I pray that at the end of my life, not one person would know my name, and more people would know the name of Jesus, Lord. Yes. That I would look at my legacy, not by how many people knew Daniel Creation, but how many people came to know Jesus Christ. Yes. Lord, that is a hard prayer for me, but Lord, I pray that you would just continue to move and mold me into the pastor that you're calling me to be. And form us into the church that you're calling us to be, Lord God. God, we love you and thank you in your holy, precious name. Amen. 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 Amen.